Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy. I'm joined this week with pure evil incarnate, the devil on the shoulder of professional wrestling, Alastor Adams. Don't want to get the name wrong straight away. Yeah. Alastor Adams, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Good to be here.
How's it going?
It's going good, yeah. Well, about as good as it can be with our current situation, but yeah.
Yeah, that's it. We're just trying to keep ourselves busy. Some people, like a lot of people, are trying this podcast thing, much like myself, but others are just trying to just keep the days going, I suppose. But we'll start with the most boring question, as I said before we hit record. How did you get into pro wrestling?
Well, as probably a lot of people give this answer as well, but I was young and looking for something to do, and I just kind of stumbled across wrestling randomly. I'm going to show my age here about how young I am in comparison to some other people, but I found wrestling on YouTube. The first match I ever saw was Edge versus Rey Mysterio. And I just kind of kept going on from there. And eventually the first pay-per-view I saw was WrestleMania 25. It just kind of snowballed from there and ended up looking for classes, and it all evolved from there.
So you have aged me terribly, because the first WrestleMania I remember watching was a VHS, and that's a videotape. It was WrestleMania 15. So that's
a 10-year difference.
10-year difference between WrestleManias. I've got you've done interviews with us in the past on the website. Yeah. For those that are interested, they can go on to swnscotland.com. Great plug. Didn't really mean it, but there we go. So 2006 was when you kind of started watching. Was Rey Mysterio one of the ones that caught your eye immediately? Just the mask and all that?
Definitely. All the high-flying stuff. I was just kind of amazed that a human could do that. So it just immediately hooked me. That match I saw as well had The Undertaker do an interference. So immediately I was just like, what is going on? It's so confused.
That's the thing. I mean, it's depending on where you jump in. It doesn't matter what time. It always seems to be that the time you watch it is the one that you find the best, even if it's something like, I don't know, league years of 2010. For example, if someone started watching then, that's the best time.
Yeah,
like, for me, I really got into it just at the tail end of Attitude into Ruthless Aggression. So that's my favorite time, in my opinion. But so Edge, Undertaker, Mysterio, that's a pretty good trio to start off with. Is there any other ones that caught your eye initially that you became a big fan of?
Well, again, going back to Ray, I saw Royal Rumble 2006 pretty early on as well. Obviously, he'd done his run from number two to the end. So pretty much all the guys in that Rumble, Triple H had a huge run in it, Randy Orton in the last two. Those guys were kind of my go-to favorites from then on. All the guys who made their name in the Ruthless Aggression as well, John Cena, Orton's big run.
2006, was that the one? I could be totally wrong here. Was that the one with Snitsky's elimination? No, it's 2005, Paul London. That was 2005, I think.
Bobby Lashley just throwing Sylvain over the top rope in 2006. That was awesome.
Sylvain, there's a mention. You see Rene Dupree popping up everywhere. You never see Sylvain anymore.
Yeah, that Rumble had some special ones in it that you've just never heard from again.
I thought that's the best thing about it. The Rumble's the best. I mean, we're just, what, a couple of days off, a week away from Rumble happening. It's the best. It's the start of Road to WrestleMania. If you need to, if you want to get into it, that's the time you get into it to get the Road to WrestleMania.
That's when you learn everybody that's in the company, pretty much.
Exactly. I mean, it's a bit harder nowadays when there's like a million wrestlers in WWE, but definitely around about 06, I had everyone you did, and that was it. You knew everyone. So how did you go? So you said you looked for training. How did you go from I'm watching this, I'm loving it, to I want to do it? Did you have an athletic background that go with it?
Well, at the time I was maybe like 12, 13 when I started looking at it. I was doing other stuff, like I went to judo classes and stuff here and there, but it wasn't really like captivating for me because I just kind of had a vague interest. But with wrestling, it was something that I actually enjoyed. So when I found out, hey, I could go and learn this, then I was kind of like, okay, drop everything else and go for this.
So the judo then, so when you actually started, I don't know how the place you started, what their setup was for, like if they started on mats or if you went straight to the ring, but with a judo background then, you had a bit of experience landing.
Yeah.
Did you find that a bit easier to do?
Yeah, so with judo, obviously, you learn breakfalls pretty early on, and they're essentially the same for wrestling. So it kind of helped with not being really sore right away when I started, which helped a lot. So it was on mats when we started, so it was essentially the exact same.
So how long did it take between starting on mats to actually getting into a ring and feeling the pain of the ropes for the first time?
So it was we were training on mats for a few years, but we would get to train in the ring every now and again, like before a show or something. So that happened maybe about a year or so into training, and when I first learned to hit the ropes, it's one of the big barriers if you're not starting in a ring right away, because hitting the ropes and running back and forth is a feeling unlike anything else, because you don't expect to just be thrown in one direction. If you can't keep balance, then you're hitting the floor.
It's unnatural. It's unnatural as well. I mean, if you throw anyone in real life towards something, they're not going to bounce up off it and then come back to you.
Yeah.
So it's a strange feeling. It's one of those curious things where, like I asked, especially in this latest run of podcasts, I seem to ask everyone about running the ropes because it's just so...
Yeah.
It looks so easy to watch it, but I know from interviews and what have you, that it's just, there's so much thought you have to put into that moment.
Yeah.
So you got to make sure your back hits flat or at least enough so you're not burning yourself on it. You got to make sure you take enough steps to turn. You got to not fall over. I don't know how anyone could do that without just brain exploding midway through it.
Yeah, especially seeing, like, when you see someone new starting and they try to hit the ropes and you notice, like, these a million things that need to be changed right away because they're used to copying what they've seen. So you see them hit the ropes and the legs up like John Cena does, and you're like, you're going to go right out the back of that ring.
Or the Rey Mysterio 2, just going to the middle rope or something like that.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone getting the same William Regal treatment, shouting to step on the left foot and whatever it was. I'm totally wrong. If ever I watch this, I'm probably wrong, and he's going to, like, tweet me and shout at me or something.
Regal's going to be knocking on your door in any second.
I know. He's going to knock on the door and go, right foot. It's right foot. It's not left. And I'll be like, I don't know what to do. Anyway, could you sign my book? So you went from that. How long did it take you? So a year from mats to the ring, how long did it take from that point to go into an actual match with people?
So I started really young. So it took me a good while before I actually had a match. So started around 12. So it was almost 4 years before I actually had a match in front of a crowd. So long time, but more practice for me. So
absolutely. Was it like a friends and family thing, or were you just throwing this deep end with customers?
We'd done friends and family when I was a little bit younger because, you know, there's more room for error that way. But the first main show I was on was, I was 16 and I had these awful plain black tights, and I had two matches on that show. The first match was a match against a guy, and it lasted 2 minutes. So out I went, got put in a full Nelson, and that was it. Game over. Then the second match was a tag team battle royale, which is it sounds like a Vince Russo creation, but it was a bunch of guys, and the last two winners would become the tag team champions. And I won that match, which was a weird way to kick off a career.
So yeah, two matches in, you're already a champion. Again, another question I ask a lot of people when they, if they've won titles, it's really awkward if I ask it and they haven't. But what was it like being a fan and being able to be a champion, get hold of a belt? Because for me, I'm a belt guy. I love the look of a belt. I'll buy belts because I'm really sad. Unfortunately, I've got a mortgage now, so I can't buy them. But yeah, what was it like getting the hold of your first championship in wrestling?
It was really surreal. Like, even just being handed the belt over, I was like, this is just, it didn't feel real, but it felt kind of like I didn't deserve what was happening. But even more recently with the Reckless Intent tag team titles, there would be times where I'm just sitting in my room and just kind of have the tag belt and just looking at it like, this is just so bizarre. And I just kind of like hang it up in different places and like move it around the room until I lost it and then had to hand it over.
I never even won one other outside of an eBay bidding war. But yeah, I know myself that you probably had that moment every morning. You look at it and go, just throw it over the shoulder and just have a wee wander around and then put it back down again.
Well, the night I won it, the first thing I did was head backstage. I didn't talk to anybody. In the Murison Scout Hall, Reckless Intent's main venue, there's a little kitchen area, and the first thing I did was head to the back and put it in the fridge and take a photo.
The old CM Punk special.
Yeah.
why not? So, like I say, you're in that company, have less than stellar reputation, that's why we're not mentioning the company's name.
Yeah.
But you did have a match with Joey Legend. Of course, you would have been way too young to know of Just Joe. From the WWF Heat days. And then he went to TNA. So what was it like going into the ring with a veteran like Joe?
That was definitely one of the high points, for sure. I did make sure to do my research on him before the match went ahead, so I at least knew who he was, and we'd done a few seminars with him as well, so I at least knew Joe before we had the match. It was good fun, like... Joe tries to pop everybody during the match. So he told us a story about another match he had before we had our match. And he told us about this guy he was wrestling who had a clothesline as a finisher. And it was called the Big Effing Clothesline. And so we're in our match and he lifts me up by the hair. And he's about to run to the ropes and he leans in and goes, "Big effing clothesline." And I'm sitting there trying not to laugh as he hits the ropes and lines me and I backflip off of it just so I can land on my face and try not to laugh into the canvas.
Joe Legend. I mean, I love his matches because he tells you what he's going to do. And it's the most, most logic-breaking way to wrestle, yet it's so great to watch at the same time. I don't know why, because if you're sitting there watching him go Brainbuster, of course being a favorite, it shouts Brainbuster, and I'm thinking, why isn't the guy just going, "Oh, I better not go up for a Brainbuster, I better just stay here, I'll leave the ring, why am I going up for a Brainbuster?" But Joe Legend, we did the Rock and Wrestle shows. I think I spoke to him, including a very very awkward car journey where my car broke and I was going 30 miles an hour between Inverness and Aberdeen, or vice versa. It was a very long trip. We spoke about anything but wrestling, so I'm assuming it was kind of the same as well outside the ring, outside of actual seminars. We spoke about Broadway shows and shows he'd go to in Germany, and my girlfriend, wife now, girlfriend at the time, loved it because she ended up, it was me, Crusher Crabe, Joe Legend, and Kelly. We were all in this Renault Clio, which isn't a big car. So
that was my previous car as well, so I get it.
It was the extreme version, which made it sound manly, but it wasn't. but no, she got there and she went, "Oh, I really like that Joe guy. We spoke about Aladdin and all these Disney things. It was amazing." And then he came out as the heel. And she just looked so sad.
I do remember having a Disney conversation with him as well.
But it was just the sadness in her face just came apparent, going, "Oh no, is he the bad guy?" Just, oh, well, best day. Best, surely been like three shows at that point. So it was just like, they're not all nice. But yeah, so you were with them for a number of years. Because I saw your name pop up because I did the results for them when they were around. And but eventually decided to move on to a company that was actually operating in the same area, Reckless Intent. Yeah. So what made you decide to move over, if you don't mind me asking?
I kind of hit a roof of I'm not getting anywhere anymore, because with that company I was essentially teaching more than I was training, and I felt like I was in no position to be doing that. So I essentially just one day just got fed up and contacted Reckless Intent and ended up there 2 days later at a training class and never looked back.
I know from previous interviews and things I've seen with Michael Chase, he was very much a, well, he came from that school originally. So he was like, right, I don't want to do anything that they've done or made him feel. So did you find a very welcoming environment when you went from the competition to them?
So right away, like, any guy from Reckless that you interview is going to say the same, that Michael Chase is an awesome guy. But he really looked out for me because he knew where I came from. And he made sure to focus on me stepping up my game every week. And it was a big step, because I went from essentially not progressing at all to pushing myself every week, because he was a ruthless coach. He really wanted everybody to improve, so he would push everybody to do that as much as possible.
I mean, even from not just from a wrestling standpoint, I know when I got contacted by Reckless Tent initially, they went, do you want to do an interview with us? And I was like, all right, that's fine. It's 2013, 14 when it just started. And it's the most detailed interview that I ever did written, because he sent me 3 pages on Word with his answers. And I was like, wow, okay. And then he was like one of my first actual interviews. So anyone, again, great plugs today. If you're on the YouTube channel, then it is on there. Mikey and Rollins, it's called. But he was one of the first guys that are like, great, let's do a phone interview. So he's one of those guys that just, I think he just sees something, I hope. He just sees something and goes, right, I can do something with this. I can push it forward a little bit more. So what was it like getting to that? Was it a total different experience when you got into the ring for the first time with Reckless Intent with their rabid fan base?
Yeah, so pretty much when I started Reckless Intent, as soon as I walked through the door, there was ideas presented to me right away. So I was instantly, after a month or so training with them, I was sent out for my first show with them, and immediately there was such a huge difference. The production value, for one, was way higher. The setup, the lights, everything was completely different to what I was used to. And then the fan base, so much louder, and they felt like Reckless Intent was their home. And I felt like I had to push myself harder to kind of fit in and prove myself to a new audience. So it was pretty intimidating, but I feel like now that I've become a mainstay with Reckless Intent, that they at least understand who I am and that I'm not a nice person and they should hate me.
Your character has evolved quite a lot over the years, starting with back when you began. It was the dyed hair and the bandana, eyeshadow, panda eyes. I don't know if that's a technical term for it. Was there any inspiration that you took to come up with that, or was it even a way to, I don't know, hide your emotions so you didn't have to kind of interact with the crowd? I don't know what I'm speaking about, but hopefully you understand what I'm saying there.
Yeah. So when I first started, I was just the generic good guy with no character, and I hated it. I hated it so much. I hated coming out the curtain and yelling, come on, like every other good guy.
The claps.
The claps, everything. It was awful. I hated it. So I was kind of pushed to get more of a gimmick. So I went with basically I was a Steel Panther ripoff. I had the leopard print tights and the fluffy boots and everything. But it was just something about being a happy, clappy, good guy still. I just hated it so much. So eventually I morphed it into a more bad character that even when I was still portraying a good guy, I kind of acted a bit more moody. And that's when it kind of clicked that, yeah, maybe I should just be an overall bad guy. And so it evolved from there. At first, it was just kind of moody teenager, angsty bad guy with the eyeshadow and whatnot. And I enjoyed that at first until it kind of ran its course and there was nothing more I could really do with that character. And then when I started with Reckless Intent, it kind of morphed into a more demonic, Satanist kind of deal with when I was tag teaming with Justin Deed and we became Divinity. Fun fact behind that name, when I joined Reckless Intent, I originally intended to change my character and be called Divinity myself until I pitched that idea to Michael Chase and he's like, that's a good tag name, we'll do that instead. I'm like, oh, okay. So yeah, ever since then it kind of evolved more and more until up until the Deadly Sins, which of course takes more from religious aspects as well. And yeah, that still evolving to this day.
Certainly, we'll definitely speak about all that kind of stuff. We'll kind of round off the starting point of your wrestling journey with Jacin. Was just asking, what was it like? You said in like doing the happy clappy stuff. Were you comfortable performing in front of a crowd initially, or was that something you had to kind of build upon?
At the start, I was definitely like a deer in the headlights. Like, I was totally scared. I wasn't confident in what I was doing. Even though things weren't going horrible or bad or anything, I just had no confidence in myself. But it did evolve over time and I got better. But at the start, for sure, I was absolutely terrified.
I suppose at the end of the day, you've got to try and, as long as they react, that's the most important thing. Yeah. The rest of it, you can try and kind of control from that point onwards. So you came to Reckless Intent. Brandon Adams was the name at the time. Of course, not the name now. You evolved this moody goth character more. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't long before you were part of Divinity, just indeed, and The Cure Delves in Dare. So these are two, to you, brand new guys. You probably would have encountered them in training or what have you. So what was it like moving on to, again, Reckless Intent, but as part of a tag team and trying to get the ideas rolling with that?
Yeah, so the second I walked through the door with Reckless, my hair was green at the time. Justin's hair was also green. So that was essentially like, oh, you two are together. So it went from there. At the time, Justin was aligned with Delson Dare as well. So all of us got put in together. And essentially, me and Justin just went aside and were like, if we're together, then we should work stuff out and just be as good as we can together. So we started developing a move set, tag moves, mannerisms, what we can do together. And it was really, I think me and Justin worked together because we were very different people. I was a very calm and collected person, and Justin, in the ring, his rage would take a hold. So I was kind of like his keeper in a way.
I mean, and also with your experience, you probably would have had a bit more experience on Justin. I think Justin was a fairly new name as well. So you got to kind of draw a little bit of your past doing teaching and build upon that as well. So I can't remember the order of this. I'm going to guess now. But you became hardcore champion during the first round of Divinity. That would be your first title outside of the other place. Did that feel different because you felt you'd actually kind of maybe earned it a bit more this time? How was that for you?
It was different, yeah. I felt like it was the first kind of championship that I would actually consider like a real accolade. to put on my resume or whatever. Even though the Hardcore Championship is a funny one because it was a 24/7 rule, so pretty much everybody got a shot. Like, everybody on the roster got to win it at some point. But it was about a year into my run with Reckless that I won that title, so it definitely felt like I had at least earned something that time around.
So, yeah. I love the Reckless 10 Hardcore title. I don't know if it's still, if it was kind of,
I think it's
put away.
Been semi-retired at this point.
Yeah, all titles have, I suppose, at this point. But yeah, when Deacon Awesome won it, that was kind of, there was never anything official, so I always had it on our champions thing, but yeah. It was never defended again, so I wasn't sure. But yeah, some odd game. Doug Williams has won that title. So yeah. You've won the same title as Doug Williams and Darren Tigos. But yeah. So and Bobby Roberts. So I mean there's some great names that have held that title over the years, Weijer.
Yeah, for sure.
So from that point onwards, I mean Reckless 10, I was just having a look through your matches just because that's how I do my notes, just to pick out one or two. And there was two names that just stood out to me of matches that you had. One was the tag team match, which involved Grado.
Yeah.
The other one was BT Gunn. That's two matches that came to mind. So they are two big names in Scotland. That's probably, I would say, going through your match list, outside of Joe Legend, of course, because he's the biggest one, he's the best one. Turning Trump there. What was it like going into the ring with Grado for the first time?
So that was a lot of fun. In that match, I was actually working hurt. I'd strained my knee pretty badly in training a few weeks before. But I kind of pushed myself because I knew that match was coming up and I didn't want to miss it. So I was tagging with Justin and Delson, I believe. So trying to plan that match was really fun because the crowd we had were really loud for that show. So we were kind of trying to work everything around Grado getting the big pop for the hot tag and whatnot. The biggest pop we got in that match was when we were beating down Grado's tag partner and Grado came in and just broke up a pin and they exploded just for that. And that was pretty much the biggest thing he'd done for that whole match. And it just goes to show what kind of effect he has on a crowd when he can do something so simple and get such a reaction just for that.
It's one of those things where you can look back and go, you just step back and go, wrestling's easy.
Yeah.
This is just simple. It's just... Oh man!
Maybe I don't need to do 1,000 flips after all.
Exactly. I don't. I listen to Wrestling Daft quite a lot, and it's just fine to hear Grado speaking. But like that, if he does a bump in a match, then he'd be surprised because it's just that it's that easy for it to get a crowd reaction. And that's kind of, I suppose, for you came out with a sore knee, but that's kind of how you want to.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you want them to do it. You can do it as long as possible and take as little bumps as possible, and then you're golden. So that was a tag team match, though. So you had other players involved. The one with BT Gunn, though, was a one-on-one match.
Yeah.
And speak about chalk and cheese between Grado and BT Gunn. BT he likes to kick. So how was that match in comparison? Did you do quite a bit more prep in the run-up to it?
Yeah, for sure. I felt like that match was probably my first kind of big test in Reckless Intent to show that I could kind of hang in bigger matches and stuff like that. Before that match, I was getting ready the whole day. BT Gunn was late for the show and we were on second. So to say I was nervous would be an understatement because he showed up 15 minutes before we were to go out. So we were running through everything, like working out how the match is going to go. And it went great. We threw in some stuff we both kind of had prepared already, mashed it all together, and it ended up working really well. As far as I can remember, the crowd were into it. It got a lot of good reviews backstage, and BT Gunn even went up to Michael Chase and told him, like, wow, I didn't know the guys you trained would be that good. And he was like, okay, I'll take that as a compliment. So
absolutely.
So yeah.
So, I mean, at that point, you had been wrestling for, what, I don't know, 5 years, something like that, on and off?
Around that, yeah.
So, how do you like to operate your matches? Do you like knowing the who, what, when's, or are you more of a bullet point, right? If we get this, then the rest we'll kind of figure out on as we go along, or are you a bit more meticulous?
I'm not very selfish when it comes to matches, so the first thing I try to do with my opponent is try and learn what their moveset is and try and work around getting their stuff in before mine. So I usually like to find out what the finish of the match is first, because that's when I know that I can settle down and get to the end. I like to tell stories with matches rather than 100 flips and tons of kicks and let's beat each other up for 50 minutes and chant fight forever. So looking back on my match, or a tag match, me and Delson Dare against the Odd Squad, Freddy the Fanboy and Craig Forsyth, the whole story we tried to tell with that match was just us absolutely leathering Freddy until he couldn't stand anymore. He took a proper beating in that match, and I think the match is up on YouTube if you want to see it, but he just gets absolutely destroyed in that match. Then Craig finally gets his hot tag at the end, and he's lighting us up and throwing us around and throwing us over the ropes and everything until we finally isolate Freddy at the end. He takes another beating, and then he rolls me up at the end and wins the tag titles. And that's probably one of my favorite matches because the reaction at the end is so good for Freddy.
Awesome. I mean, yeah, so you like to work from the end and then backwards from there. I've already said on the podcast, because I've done so many of them now, I've run out of all my own stories, and I'm just recapping them, repeating them now. But yeah, some of my favorite matches I've ever watched have involved maybe four moves. But the anticipation, the story, the little moments and subtleties that actually lead to the final conclusion and the crescendo, that's the best bit. I mean, I'm the same as you. I see things like death matches and all these flippy stuff, and I'm like, that's great, and I'll enjoy that in isolation or maybe every so often, but give me a match with a story, and that's all I need.
There's definitely a place for flips and athletics. Like, I would say, even look at the Young Bucks. Like, they get a lot of flack for just being flippy guys, but I feel like they managed to blend that with telling a story, and I feel like they're probably the only guys that managed to pull that off really well.
I think they're definitely a little better than they were, if I remember rightly. They used to just be those guys that would just do all the moves, and now they can. I don't know if it's age or their knees have decided that we need to do, I could do all the super kicks, but we'll leave the flips until the end and just make a story out of it, which is always the best way. But so Justin Deed, which is an amazing name. There was a couple that came around about that time. I don't know. I think it was Justin Reckless that had just incredible pun names. It would be in the head, Looking Sharp is around as well. And that's, give me all that. I love him. So Justin Deed moved on, and he ended up winning the tag titles with Delton Deere. I think you're the second champions, if I remember rightly.
Third, I think.
So it was Adrian Orion. I thought you were second. And then did they come back to win them? And then you won.
It was Adrian Orion won it and then relinquished on the first day because of Michael Chase's injury. Then iGen won them.
Of course.
And then dropped them back to the Age of Orion. Then it went back to us.
Apologies to David Devlin and Kieran Kelly. My apologies. Double to Kieran Kelly for forgetting your name for a moment as well. First tag team title, first proper tag team title with Dells and Dare. And that must be pretty good feeling. You've spent all that time building this character, building this duo up, and then rewarded for your efforts. What was it like facing Michael for that title especially?
It was good, obviously that was Michael Chase's last title before he retired, So it kind of felt like, in some sort of way, passing on the torch of the tag division in Reckless over to us. And it was a lot of weight on our shoulders. That match as well was really fun. It was a TLC match. So, which I don't do too often, to say the least. So it was a big change. We had a lot of fun stuff in that match, even though most of it was Michael and Delson wrestling each other off the ladder, trying not to get the belt.
So I've seen some of the Reckless's their hardcore matches. Some of them are just ridiculously wild, especially when the matches have been in the Scout Hall or even in the unit. Where they're in the unit, it's just how and why. It's you look watching them. And I think there was one. I think it was actually Michael Chase jumping off a ladder through a table, and I'm just like, that's insane. Especially that goes to show his passion, because there's probably maybe 40 people there watching him do it. Next tank crowd. It sounds like 1,000.
Even in that last TLC match we had there, the last thing Michael Chase took was he went for a slice bread number 2 on Delson and just kind of got thrown out of the ring through a door. Like, why do you do this stuff to yourself?
Reckless Intense, their obsession with doors. I mean, I've seen they're cheaper than tables, but their obsession with doors, it's one of those things where every time I hear it going, oh, it's a mystery doors match, I'm thinking, that sounds stupid. And then I watch it and go, oh, don't go through the door. I still get brought in by the story, even if it's the most ridiculous of ways to do it. Again, go back to that like Russo-esque stuff. It's like, it sounds terrible, but in action, it's actually okay. I love reverse battle royals. I love the idea of it. God. Even the execution of it was so ridiculous that I still loved it. But a mystery doors match is up there with ones going, that seems like a ridiculous idea, but somehow it works. So for Reckless Intent, you've ventured out even further. So you made appearances in Respect Pro and Source, and we'll speak about Discovery in a bit. So was it just a case of that you've got comfortable in Reckless and thinking, right, I can try and move to other places, or did they contact you and think, let's get Adams over?
Well, with Respect Pro, it was one of their first shows they ran that I was part of, and Delson Dare was originally scheduled to tag with somebody else, but I got called in instead, and this was kind of before me and Delson were tagging properly. I was still kind of just aligned with him in Reckless. So that was kind of the precursor to the Deadly Sins a few years beforehand. And it was a lot of fun because I didn't know I was going to be wrestling for them until a couple of days before. So I just kind of threw everything together, worked out and headed up, and it was a lot of fun. With Source, the first match I had for them was one of their shows in their unit. And that was one of my most fun matches I've ever had. It was me, Jetstream Jack now, Sammy Joe and Manlin in a fatal four-way.
The Highland dancing, that was it. I didn't realise that was your first one. That was your first match in Source.
That was great. The venue was absolutely freezing. So we just decided to have some fun with it, and because everyone was in high spirits for that show. It was a lot of fun. So we went out, had a dance, I ruined it for everybody, and they instantly hated me for it. It was great.
I love the Source crowd when I watch the shows, their shows, especially the Govan one, but Govan crowd's just nuts. Yeah, they're hyped on sugar. That was
my last match before we've all been locked down was a Govan show for Source. It was a 6-man scramble that I ended up winning, and even like for all the crowds I've seen, walking out into the Govan crowd for the first time was special. It was definitely a lot different than what I was used to.
I mean, I've watched that match on YouTube actually, but their crowd is just that's. I mean, likes of Reckless and Source, they just have their kind of their constant crowd, which is great.
Yeah.
That first show, I remember I was speaking to, I don't know if I actually spoke to Grant McIver about it. I definitely spoke to EDM about it. His favourite mm-hmm. moment was Grant's match, where he spoke about the venue being freezing. He entered, walked out, and turned off the heating.
Turned the heating off, yeah. And that was the biggest heat anybody got for the whole show.
The irony of the thing, switching off and so you're pretty good at this multi-man matches now, especially Discovery Wrestling. You entered the Reckless Raffle Royal, so you had the winning ticket to enter the match. Again, love this concept, love it. Raffles and wrestling, they all go together.
They just go together.
So again, brand new audience, and Discovery audience especially is like a hybrid. It's not a kid's show. It's not an adult show. It's like a teen show where they act like kids but look like adults.
Yeah.
So how was it like going into that environment when there's a very, very different crowd?
It was intimidating for all of us. So there was 10 of us in the match, and all of us were really nervous because the only people in that match who had been on Discovery beforehand, I think, were Jetstream Jack, Rob Mills, and Delson Dare. The rest of us were completely new, other than kind of seeing us around working security beforehand, and if they knew us from Reckless or whatever. But it was intimidating. We were all kind of sat in the gorilla position that they have backstage at the Jam House, all kind of shaking in our boots, like wondering how it's going to go. But we went out there and we had a lot of fun. We kind of started off all attacking the big guy, Grom, at the start, and that was fun. He just kind of threw us around, and we had a lot of fun with it. We tried to work to what that audience would like, which is lots of wrestling-y stuff. So I busted out the backslide driver at the end of that match, which was essentially me throwing Stephen Miles on his head and then throwing him out the ring. And that seemed to get a good reaction, so I think it went pretty well.
Yeah, Discovery are a weird bunch, though, because you say that, like, the wrestling stuff, and then next match will be Gene Money against Session Moth Martina, which will involve no wrestling. or a zombie. There'll be zombies. Then it'll just be, again, Gene Money. I don't know why this name keeps cropping back when I think about the weirdness that can come with Discovery Wrestling. So that's five companies you worked for, four hopefully regular ones. Is there any aspirations, anyone you want to face in the future in Scottish wrestling in general, or you just want to get back wrestling first, I suppose?
Yeah, for sure. I really want to get back to it. With Discovery as well, winning that Reckless Raffle also won me a chance to enter the Derby, the Disco Derby. Obviously, that never went ahead, but hopefully that spot is still retained for when shows come back. So hopefully we can enter that, face a bunch of different guys in a different rumble, hopefully become a mainstay on their roster, because I would argue that Discovery Wrestling has one of the best overall rosters that gets used in Scottish wrestling today. So pretty much anybody on there would be great.
Definitely hard to disagree with that. Since all this lockdown stuff and then all the stuff that happened over the summer, Discovery have really kind of proven themselves to be like for the fans. So they've kept everyone transparent, clear what they're doing, how they're doing things, which is really great to see. I wish some other companies would follow suit with that as well.
Yeah.
Some have, some haven't, but you know, it's just the way it is at the moment. So is there any companies that you want to try and get to when everything's back to normal?
I would say the main thing that I want to start with is maybe venturing down to working down south. I've pretty much exclusively wrestled in Scotland so far. So the biggest goal is to start heading out to other places, England, maybe even Wales, Ireland, even outside of the UK. That's the, I would say, short-term goal. for when wrestling starts proper again. But yeah, just as many places as I can be.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, yeah, absolutely. I mean, if just getting wrestling, I suppose.
Yeah.
Right. So, as far as your character, so like say you went from just the moody goth to a moodier goth. I've used the goth too many times. I feel like I'm going to offend goths by saying it. But it's pretty much how it looks. But it's now becoming more sinister. Was that kind of the outward goal when you started this look, the black hair, jet black hair, tattoos, black gear, but not the boring black tights? Was it always kind of an evolution you were thinking of to make it darker and darker?
It was never really something I thought of initially. It just kind of progressed that way because when I aligned with Delson there, he already kind of had his character was sort of going in that direction. And then when we started with the Deadly Sins, it kind of went all the way with that. And we started including more religious undertones and started accusing people of being sinners and stuff like that. And that was a lot of advice we took for that, because a lot of people have input on those kind of characters. So we essentially got as much advice from as many people as possible. And they all wanted us to take it a more demonic route, because a lot of people have dark characters in wrestling now, but they all tend to take it to more of a silly kind of route. But we wanted to take ours really seriously, well, as serious as we can with wrestling. And we just wanted to kind of stand out. And now I'm kind of taking that in my own direction as well with the pure evil thing. Where I kind of want to be like this black spot on wrestling that kind of makes everything a downer. I just want people to feel hate around me.
Like, you just want the air to go cold as soon as you enter, kind of thing.
For sure.
Yeah, I mean, that in itself, I mean, I can only think of maybe, I don't know, two or three possibly off the top of my head that's kind of got something that similar sinisterness. So it is... it does have, as you say, the darkness, dark characters do happen a lot, but there's not that many that actually try to actively get you to feel sad at their mere presence, which is it's a hard thing to do. And anyone who tries it, we've got their work cut out, especially because indie wrestling is silly. So it's trying to shift that perception for even a moment is going to be a hard job, but you seem to be doing it just from your promos, just from your actions more than anything. I mean, spoiling Highland Dancing and what have you. You're certainly going the way it needs to make everyone feel just sad.
Just Downer. Depress everybody.
Get a valet, call her Debbie Downer, you know, can all...
going right in the notepad.
So I mean, you've got quite totally shift, but kind of in the same vein. We've got quite a lot of tattoos. You did a behind the art with our masked embroiderer, which I love the name, the masked embroiderer. I can't see it. That's the only that's the only downside. At least it's written, so I don't have to read it out as often. But there's quite a lot of not pagan symbols, but like a lot of imagery as well. Was that kind of, is that gothic religious stuff? Yeah, gothic stuff. Not gothy, but gothic. Is that something that's always kind of interests you, the gothic imagery?
For sure. Like, I grew up liking you know, metal music, rock, even more emo-y stuff when I first started learning about different bands and whatnot. So it kind of evolved from there. Like, once you get hooked on one thing and you grow up with it, that's kind of your aesthetic for the rest of your life. So it all stuck with me, like skulls, bats, that the typical gothic imagery, and I just kind of attached myself to it. And that's what made me want to get that kind of stuff tattooed on me as well, because I think it looks cool.
And it definitely adds to, like I said, definitely adds that aesthetic as well that you're trying to perceive. I suppose at the same time, you've mentioned a few times that some of your bigger matches have just been like 15 minutes or last minute that you go. that cool, calm, and collected demeanor that you have certainly lends it to that as well. Because I know for others, I'd probably be the same if I ever decided to try wrestling. I'm quite a chill person, so I'd just be like, all right, okay, cool, let's just go do it.
So you
find that really helps with your
For sure. Like on the outside, I seem like I'm all there and collected and ready to mess with people. On the inside, I'm screaming. So yeah, I think having that kind of character helps me a lot with overcoming nerves for when I wrestle as well.
So just before we move on to some non-wrestling matters, we'll probably switch back and forth because, again, if you've listened to this before, you know that there's no structure to these podcasts. It's just a case of I'll pop a question in when I can think of it. But yeah, before we move on to that, we'll ask the question so I don't forget it. What's your favourite dinosaur?
This is where I make everyone hate me when I tell them I'm not that into dinosaurs. I'm sorry. But I guess I'll give the typical answer and say a T-Rex because, you know, red Power Ranger, that kind of deal.
Ah, okay, right. You've won me back with the red Power Ranger. That's fine. That's all good.
Well, I couldn't say dragon because it's not a real dinosaur.
I think we can count it. So, like I say, Harmony Sky is used turkey dinosaur, which is my favorite answer. Oh,
that's a smart idea.
Exactly. So I think dragon counts as a dinosaur.
Okay, well, yeah, we'll go with dragon then.
Specifically the Dragonzord, or
they call themselves dinosaurs in that show and they have a Dragonzord, so sure, we'll go with that.
So you quite like you like the nerdy things in life. If anyone goes onto your Twitter profile, they will know this. But again, before I do that, I've got Jetstream Jack asking, what's your favorite song to sing in the car?
Well, when it's with Jetstream Jack, as I'm sure he's told you in his interview, it's the Knuckles rap.
I think he did, yeah.
But I like to put on stuff that everybody in the car can sing along to, so we usually get the Disney tunes on and have a sing-along with that, or we get the wrestling entrance themes on, because we all know them, so...
I'm just imagining, like, stopping at, I don't know, traffic lights, looking and seeing yourself, Gothic, Jack, the opposite, And the pirate Rob Mills just bouncing along to like Moana.
Yeah, I mean, in one of the last car trips before lockdown, me and Delson Dare were in the front seat doing a duet of "Love Is an Open Door," and that was great fun.
Who was Hans?
Him. I was Anna.
Oh no. Well, we've got the song portion of the show. No, we're not going to do that again. I've learned my lesson that singing on these podcasts is not a good idea.
Yeah.
As anyone listening to the Shambles episode will know why. It did not go well at all. It was a good idea. We did Backstreet Boys. Wanted that way. It was a team effort. Oh, it was so bad. But the other thing, I mean, I looked this out specifically for for this interview. For those that are watching the video stream, they will know what that is. But for those that are on the audio one, it is a little question box from Super Mario.
Lights up.
I was going to have it lit up the whole time, but you can't see it.
Yeah, you can't really see what it is.
So there it is. You've caused some controversy. As of a recording of your Super Mario opinions, is Mario being a game that you're a gamer? We think we can establish that. Was Mario one of the first ones that you were into?
Yeah, for sure. The first console, well, it's not really a console, but the first game machine I ever owned was a Game Boy Color, and I had Super Mario Land for that. So it was that Mario was one of my first exposure to video games in general.
I've got a color somewhere. It's not in this room. I would have taken it out otherwise. But I remember I had a Pikachu edition one for a bit. Mm-hmm. It was amazing. So Mario Land, I think I might actually have that as well somewhere. And Sonic is the other one that I know that you're quite a big.
If anyone's seen me and Jetstream Jack's interactions, you will know that we love Sonic. He's one of our favorite video game characters.
Now, as far as movies go, obviously, once better than the other. I haven't seen Sonic the Hedgehog the movie yet. Is it something? Does it hold up to the video game experience?
Well, it's everybody knows that video game movies never really turn out great, as evidenced by every single video game movie ever made. But I would say Sonic is probably the best video game movie ever made. There's a lot of reference to the original game. I think fans will like it. So I'd say it's not a great movie by any means. It's definitely a kid's film, but it's not bad. That's about as good as it can get.
What were your thoughts when you saw the first design of Sonic for the movie?
I mean, I wasn't surprised. I had this like gut feeling that I knew it would be terrible, but even when it was first revealed, I couldn't believe they would do something like that. like there must be so many people that go through checks and like design this and have to approve it, and every single one of them signed off on that saying it was okay. Like, I can't believe that.
I saw the Ferrari about it. I think there's a good word about it, and yeah, it just didn't look right. It was just so weird. But yeah, I'll have to check it out at some point. I can't remember the last time I watched Super Mario. I think I only watched it once for good reason.
That's one too many times.
I don't know. I don't know if it was just because Bob Hoskins is in it and I love Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I don't know what made me watch it. But
he actually went on to say that was the biggest regret of his career, the Mario Bros. Movie. So.
But yeah, I'll have to watch Sonic. I keep meaning to, and then it's one of those things, anything with Netflix or Prime or anything like that, you look at it and go, oh, 2 hours. I can't sit for two hours.
I'll stick it on the list.
I'll stick it on the list, and then you go watch four episodes of 1 hour things and go, that's fine. Time well spent. Are you into the Marvel stuff as well?
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, thank God.
Yesterday, I just watched through all of WandaVision and got completely caught up. So, yeah, definitely.
Wonderful, because I need someone to speak to about WandaVision. we'll try and keep it spoiler-free, although when this goes out, the first season will be finished. So,
yeah.
For those that are on the Patreon, patreon.com/ScottResnet, fire with the links to the, they won't know. How amazing is WandaVision?
Oh, so good. Like, the first two episodes, I was kind of like, is this really what we're going for? Like, is this like just a multiverse thing and we're just following this sitcom? But as soon as things started kicking off, then I was just hooked completely. Like, it's crazy the stuff they're trying to pull off now.
Yeah, it's when it was like the reviews came in, but the critics only got to see the first three episodes. You know, thinking, that's weird. And then episode four started, you're like, oh God, this is why they only got to see the first three episodes. Because, amazing. So as far as heroes and villains, are you a bit more of the villain side, anti-heroes, Venom, that kind of thing, just with your gothic vibe? Or who's your favourite superheroes?
Oh, wow. Well, my favourite hero is Thor. I kind of feel like in every interpretation of Thor, there's always so many highlights, and especially MCU, he's just unquestionably the best character, and I won't take any questions on that, because he just is. Villain-wise, villains are a lot tougher, because they're kind of their own thing. Joker, in the most recent Joker movie, is amazing. Never been big on Venom, which probably will get me a lot of hate. But
especially from Dells and Deer.
Yeah. But I've always just kind of thought that the Venom thing, like, every kind of sci-fi show has something like that. The kind of evil version of good characters, even though Venom's kind of a separate thing. But, yeah, never really been a fan. But with Joker as well, like, everybody loves Joker. But I feel like the only Joker I really like is the most recent one with the new movie and Mark Hamill's Joker in the animated series.
Not a fan of the Heath Ledger one, is that just a bit too
out there for you? This will get me a lot of hate as well, but I don't like the Dark Knight movies.
I didn't even know Batman Begins existed. I started watching from the Dark Knight onwards, and then someone went, oh, that's the second one.
Yeah.
Why? What's the, everyone knows what Batman is about at this point. You don't need to do an intro. You don't need to do an origin story. His parents are dead. Wow. That's about it. Yeah. That's all you need to know.
That's why I'm glad they didn't do that with Spider-Man again with the new MCU movies and just done his backstory and we watch Uncle Ben get shot for the fourth or fifth time.
I was going to say, I don't need to see Uncle Ben die again. It's just, it's done at this point.
Yeah.
It's, yeah. Everyone knows what happens. He's dead. Okay, cool. Great power. Spider-Verse, though, I'm super excited about.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. Spider-Verse is, that's one of my favorite comic book movies of all time. It's just so good.
And the fact they're going to try and do it in live action, apparently, allegedly, rumored.
Yeah, we don't know for sure.
I know, we're going to get all hyped up and it's going to be the post-credit scene of Spider-Man 3, isn't it?
Well, we'll see one character that we know and that'll be it for 5 seconds.
It'll be a mid-credit scene, Tobey Maguire pops out, and then post-credit Andrew Garfield comes out and they do the whole end of Spider-Verse where they do the pointing.
Yeah, they point at each other.
I'd be okay with that, actually. I think I'd actually be okay with that, which just shows how...
The pop for J. Jonah Jameson at the end of the last Spider-Man film was enough for me, so...
Oh, man. Yeah, I watched that in the most... I went to go see it in the cinema just because it was on, and my wife was going to see the Westlife concert. It was being streamed in the cinema at the same time. So she came out buzzing, and I was like, J. Jonah Jameson!
That was the highlight of that whole movie.
Oh, absolutely incredible. So we're going to swing back to wrestling quite briefly. Yep. So during this lockdown time, it's been a bit weird. There's been no wrestling on. The only kind of competition we've got is a ridiculous person decided to do a Twitter poll competition that you, for some reason, decided to take part in as well.
Yeah.
And revealed, not even revealed, but confirmed your love of Shadow the Hedgehog.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Several times before promising to make Jetstream Jack and Jarek Nowak cardboard tag team titles in the Solitaire Classic. How's that getting on? Are they in the bin?
Yeah, well, I actually tweeted Jetstream Jack either yesterday or a couple of days ago. He asked me where the belts were, and I sent him a photo of a cardboard recycling bin. So that's where those are.
Everyone was having a lot of fun of those. Was it a good way to kind of get your creative juices flowing, a bit of an outlet, or just to keep yourself busy?
Yeah, especially with one of the earlier tournaments that I took part in as well, like done a couple promos for them, got to talk a bit of trash on Twitter, so it's a lot of fun. It got us, it got everybody using their Twitter accounts again instead of just retweeting random stuff for no reason. So especially like even just watching the followers go up a little bit again, while we're interacting with each other, it's been a lot of fun.
That was kind of the main aim, that and keep myself busy outside of deleting articles for various reasons. But it was just trying to make things a bit happier and everyone to just have a go. But yeah I'm glad that yourself and others were able to find the light side of it and just go, right, we'll just go all in. We're just going to be absolute idiots about this and just go for it.
Yeah, it's got us interacting with a lot of other wrestlers that we wouldn't have interactions with otherwise as well. So,
exactly. It's kind of like that way of going into a new locker room, but without the actual pressure of
the walking around and shaking everybody's hands. Yeah,
which thankfully might be a thing of the past when the shows return. Because I mean, I don't like shaking hands anyway, but I'm definitely not going to do it.
I'm in the same boat. It's not a fun experience.
No, I mean, I'm a fairly awkward person. My very brief locker room experiences have been just sitting in the corner, hoping nobody speaks to me. And then if they speak to me, I have to think of something to say to them. There has been a moment where I walked into a locker room and there was Crusher Crabe, Aspen Faith and Sami Zayn putting together their match. I didn't want to interrupt. I wasn't going to go and put my hand out because that's weird. So I just sat at the other end of the sofa, not looking. Like, I don't know what you're saying. I'm not listening because I want to enjoy the show later. Oh, God, this is so awkward. This is so awkward. What am I doing?
my go-to is just trying to go and find something to help with the ring right away, so I just look like I'm busy, so I don't have to go around and shake people's hands.
I was just trying to look busy, but yeah, I just sat there, just looked like an absolute moron. And this is why I like Zoom calls for these interviews, because once we're done, we're done. There's no awkward little bit afterwards where we're like, "Ah, how you doing? Good. That's all good. Yeah. Where are you going later? Oh, I'm going this way. Oh shit, I'm going that. Oof. Damn it! Damn it! Ah, I was the one to do it. Got 40 odd episodes in. I'm the one to swear on it. We'll forget that. I'm not going to edit out because you know it's a landmark moment. So wrestling. So who would be your favourites now? Who are your favourites nowadays when it comes to pro wrestling?
Oh, well. Recently, the reason I started watching WWE again has been for Cesaro and Nakamura. Those two guys are just absolutely phenomenal. And their in-ring work is just unparalleled. Those two guys are great.
Yeah, so the kind of refocus on them this year has been delightful to see.
Yeah, it's kind of like everybody forgot how great they are until they started getting a spotlight again. You're like, oh yeah, those guys.
Yeah, I don't know where it's going. I don't know if it's going to be, there's going to be some big multi-man scramble thing with an Intercontinental title, which I'm all for.
Yeah, well, I had this idea because I made it clear on my Twitter a couple of days ago that I love open challenges. So why not have Cesaro with the Intercontinental title having Cesaro's world tour since he speaks like five languages?
Oh, amazing. I think he did something similar when he was US champion back in 20, whoever long ago.
I think he had an open challenge kind of deal.
Yeah. Oh, that time period was special. Oksana.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Awful wrestler. Very pretty. Awful wrestler. Oh, now I've got Oksana and NXT Marion Goldust in my head. I'm sorry to everyone that's been listening to that. Just for that, we just put that in your head.
Game show NXT in general is something that should be wiped off the memory of wrestling.
I want to say yes, but also EC3 and Daniel Bryan rigging the competitions so they would match answers every time, even though they didn't actually match the question, is still incredible. Yeah. Or Tights O'Neill falling over a barrel, which, you know, kind of...
The predecessor to the world slide.
Exactly. Absolutely. Oh, we've kind of went off there a bit. So Nakamura, Cesaro, are you big into worldwide wrestling? I kind of peg you for a Japan guy. Are you quite a fan of Japanese wrestling?
I'm one of those guys that only watches Wrestle Kingdom. That's my one experience with New Japan for the year, and that'll be it. Mainly because it's just another thing to subscribe to if I want to watch it regularly. But AEW, I've been keeping up with the stuff Kenny Omega's doing is pretty fun. Jungle Boy is one of my favorites in AEW. And Luchasaurus and their whole team, something about them, their look and their style is just extremely captivating to me.
Luchasaurus could have been your favorite dinosaur.
Oh, yeah. Can I change my answer?
Absolutely.
There we go.
Luchasaurus beats Dragonzord.
Yeah.
I find it, I've mentioned in previous episodes that I find it difficult to watch AEW because for everything, I'm like, oh, this is really cool. I quite like this. It's quite good. And then they'll make a wee dig. They'll be going, you're not doing it for me. You're doing it for a different reason. I'm not enjoying this anymore. It's weird. Even when I was saying earlier, I like stories in wrestling. They do stories, but then they do something to annoy me. And I'm like, I'm not going to go on Twitter and whinge about it. I'm just going to go, I'm just going to watch it. That's the way it should be done. So WWE seems to be your main, main way.
Excellent. Well, I do prefer older wrestling. That's just the way I am. During lockdown, I had a binge of every single ECW pay-per-view, which was a lot of ups and a lot of downs. With ECW, you either get something really great or really awful.
I can imagine that. Yeah, I'm the same. Like we were saying right at the start about the time period that you started with, that's your kind of comfort zone, your nostalgic bit.
Yeah.
I've been watching a lot of 2001, 2002 Raws. I went through the SmackDowns as well, and I didn't get all the way through them, but I did catch quite a few. One of the annoying things about the WWE Network is if someone else watches something, it kind of resets where you were. Yeah. And only recently, I'm now subscribed to my own WWE Network account after many years not being on my own, which was an absolute pain because the guy who runs it was best friend for years. We hadn't spoken since his wedding, just one of those things. But I already had his network account, so I was keeping it. So I'm not giving this up. And he contacted me out of the blue, and I went, "Oh, you watching the Rumble tonight?" And he went, "I don't usually watch, but I think I will stay up." And I was like, "You, how dare you? How dare you use your own account that you pay $9.99 for to watch it?" So to quickly make my own account again, and it was just, I mean, I've got a lot out of WWE for not paying $9.99, but still, there's a little bit of bitterness watching the Rumble going, I'm paying for this. I should not be paying for this. How dare. Anyway, right. So, yeah. Am I also right in thinking you're a big anime fan as well? Like, you Wrestle Kingdom, but you quite like anime. There's a lot of wrestlers like anime, I'm finding.
Yeah. I've noticed that a lot over lockdown as well. We've all kind of come out of the woodworks to reveal our anime love.
What is it about anime? I mean, I think I've asked every other person, but what's it about anime that does it for you?
It's such a hard thing to explain because anime is such a different concept to anything else. The best way I can put it is it's just cartoons, but cooler. Anime is kind of more adult focused, but not, you know, like rated R, like anything like that. There's more action, and depending on what you're watching, of course, anime is more story-driven than any other kind of cartoon. Yeah, I feel like it's one of those things that just kind of hooks you in, and it takes a lot to hook you in, because unless you've grown up with it, then it's pretty hard to get into, which is the same for a lot of things, honestly.
You got to say that for wrestling as well, I suppose.
Yeah.
So what would be your recommendations for, I don't know, first-time watchers?
Oof. Well, my favorite anime is Dragon Ball, which is probably the most well-known anime ever. But I will never recommend it to anybody because there's like, there's Dragon Ball, Dragon Ball Z, Dragon Ball GT, and Dragon Ball Super, and all of them are about 100 to 300 episodes long. So I'll never recommend that to anybody. But the most popular anime right now is My Hero Academia. That's what I would recommend to people. It's essentially a high school where everybody has superpowers, and the main character didn't have superpowers, but now he does have superpowers, and he's trying to catch up to everybody else.
Okay, I will bear that in mind. I think Rain also recommend that one to me as well. I still haven't got around to watching any of it. Anything. I watched One Punch Man.
One Punch Man is a lot of fun.
I said an episode that hasn't gone out, actually, out. It's on Patreon, but I can't remember who it was with. But I said, I watched it. I watched three episodes, and I was like, right, I understand the premise of this. If this is the same every episode, I'm done. I'm all right. I've got it. I got the gist of it. It's fine.
One Punch Man is just making fun of every other anime in its genre. And that's the whole joke of the whole show.
Yeah, I think I would appreciate it if I actually watched anime. Yeah. So I got it. It was just, when I was watching it, I was like three episodes in, and it was, oh no, don't come near me. I'm going to punch you. I've punched you.
Yeah.
Well, that's how it always ends. I'm like, okay, I've got this. It's it. But yeah, but I'm sure if I actually went and watched more of it, I'll, more anime in general, I would understand it a bit more. So again, we're trying to swing back into wrestling. I've written down Fair City Saints, but I think that's because when we did our starter for 10, or no, we did an actual interview way back at the start of this whole lockdown thing. Stephen Miles and Alex Webb were a couple of guys that you recommend people to kind of check out. Is there anyone else that you've trained with or wrestled that you think people should have their eyes on more?
Yeah, a lot of the guys in Reckless Intent, I feel like deserve a little more credit, especially Miles and Webb, because their work as a tag team has just kind of exploded. They kind of went from just being thrown together into these guys belong in a tag team. Jetstream Jack, one of my good friends, really underrated. Rob Mills as well, over the last 2 or so years, his improvement has just been absolutely incredible. Grom as well, he's someone to look out for, because you don't see too many big guys in Scottish wrestling anymore. You maybe get a couple here and there, and he's kind of taking that ball, picking it up and running with it. So he's one to keep an eye out for.
I'm putting money on there's going to be something. There's money in a match between Grum and Kuma.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, it won't be a technical classic by any stretch of the imagination, but that's a spectacle that you need to see.
Yeah, we all love a big guy fight.
Absolutely. I mean, Haystacks and Big Daddy made millions. Well, millions, maybe not. Inflation may have made billions, yeah. But they made a lot of money just on not a lot of doing. And you know,
even having Grom and Kuma again could pull back in the casual audience of British wrestling if you put kind of those guys and kind of compare them to Big Daddy and Haystacks as well. So there's a lot of potential there.
Absolutely. Make them a tag team. I mean, I'm sure Deadly Sins will be trying to get a match anytime soon.
Very scary for the rest of the tag team scene.
So speaking of Jetstream Jack, he says one of your best friends, he asked a question earlier. He asked a question for someone else, but I'm just going to steal it for this as well. So when are you going to become a tag team? What would be your team name? And who would you want to face?
Oh, God.
You can take out the when, because that's a silly one, because there's no shows. Yeah. But what's your team name? Who are you facing?
Me and Jack. Well, if we were teaming, I'd like to face Miles and Webb. That would just be a lot of fun with three guys that I really like. Team name.
Would Webb have to change his last name to per hour for the
No, because that would just result in Jack screaming and crying for the whole match, because he can't figure out a very simple pun.
For those that are unaware, that while Alistair thinks of a team name, today, as of recording, Jetstream Jack realised that Sonic's pal, Miles Per Hour, is a pun for Miles Per Hour.
Sonic turns 30 years old this year. And all this time that it's been out, he has not noticed this very, very simple pun, and it's driven me crazy all day.
I thought he was joking, and then the subsequent tweets following realized he is not joking at all with this.
I knew he's not the sharpest tool in the shed, but this takes the cake.
So your entrance theme is Knuckles Rap. I think we can guarantee that.
I mentioned to him that if he's Jetstream Jack, I wanted to be Airstream Alistair. So I think that would make us the streamers.
Money. There we go. Money on the table right there. The streamers. Airstream and Jetstream. You could get Go Faster stripes on your gear and everything. Yeah.
Get the Twitch logo and like modify it.
Yeah, make it like a skull instead.
Yeah.
There's money there. Between that and Debbie Downer, we've got some ideas all ready to go for when the show should turn. So, the streamers with Knuckles Rap. There's also a video that Jack made me aware of you and Rob Mills and Jack singing Pokemon tunes.
Was it Pokemon or was it Power Rangers?
I want to say it was Pokemon. But now, and you start with a P.
If it's the one with Rob Mills hitting a random splash onto me, then it was definitely Power Rangers.
It was Power Rangers. It was Power Rangers because Jack was saying that he knew like all the tunes up until, I can't remember, Wild Force maybe. I don't know where I was going with that. It just popped into my head now.
Everybody has that kind of niche thing that not too many people like, but you like for some reason. Power Rangers is that one for me. Like, so many people like the original show, but I've kind of kept up to date with every single iteration of that show up until the current one, which not a lot of people can say.
Definitely not. I think I tapped out maybe 3 or 4 in. I remember Zeo, and I probably said Injax one. I've totally forgot how far I got. I remember Zeo. I remember some stuff with Tommy coming back as the Gold Ranger.
Mm-hmm. This is where I make a lot of people hate me and say I think Mighty Morphin is one of the worst seasons overall of the whole show.
I would judge you, but I've only seen three seasons, well, three different iterations of the Power Rangers. Yeah. But I still got a little Thunderbolt, which nice. Everyone thinks it's the Flash, and I've just stopped correcting people now. But it's supposed to be Power Rangers, and yeah, everyone goes, oh, you like the Flash? No. Power Rangers, clearly.
God damn it.
Right, so you'll probably max out my knowledge very quickly then, but who's your favourite Power Ranger?
Oh, man. Do I have to pick from Mighty Morphin, or can it be any?
It could be any, but I'll know who they are if you pick them in the first couple, but any, go for
it. Okay, well, it's the Red Ranger from Power Rangers Wild Force. I actually have his helmet, his whole costume. I'm going to pull back the curtain, but if anybody's seen the Red Ranger in Reckless Intent, that was me.
Right, this is SWN Podcast with the Range Ranger now. That's just changed my mind. There we go.
If I move my camera over here, you can see them, the helmets.
Oh, man.
That is Wild Force and Ninja Storm next to each other.
I thought I had the coolest bit of merch with him yon year, but that's just... I so want a Power Rangers mask. I have no idea where I'd put it. I've got a guarantee that if it arrives in the post, my wife's going to go, why? Yeah. Why you got that? but that is amazing. That's worth checking out the video alone for those that are listening to this. Come have a look at your helmets. But I thought, no, that's a weird way to put it. So Wild Force, Red Ranger.
Yeah. Well, we can't really mention him too much these days because the actor that played him is currently in jail for manslaughter. So
I was about to say that because I thought, didn't one of the Red Rangers kill a guy? It was that one.
To clear this up, I like the character, not the actor, just to get that out there.
That old chestnut, as a wrestling fan, we've all had to go through that as well. We like the character, we don't like them. Okay, so that's a weird way to wrap up the show, but that's where we're going to go with.
That's fitting for me, so that works out.
So before we head off, we've got to do the usual. Where can people find you on social media? What's your handles?
So you can follow me at the Alastor Adams on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok, if that's your thing. That's where you can find me.
I have TikTok now. I feel very old. Yeah. When I go onto the app, I didn't need that bit of I didn't need that in my life. As soon as I went on and went, oh God, they're all so much younger than me. And then I've come onto this chat and realised that your first WrestleMania was 10 years after my one. Yeah. but thank you very much for joining me today. I'm really excited. I'm glad that you were able to take part, especially with our little last minute change of time because I've got a guy doing Windows, which he never finished. He finished at 12. Once again, we could have made our original time. But you know. You know what luck it'll be. I would have been sitting here and you'd have been hearing drilling and what have you.
Yeah. It was great fun. I was happy to be here.
Yeah. Just another quick, because again, kept popping in and out as you were speaking, but you were one of the first outside of Jack wrestlers who did an article for us way back in the day. You did your WrestleMania predictions, I think.
Oh, yeah. What one was that? What WrestleMania was that?
I will go find it because it's a teaser that I don't want to leave to the imagination. I don't know if I still have it, so I'll have to find it because I don't know if I just did it in the middle of a clear out. So for not for any reason, that was the case. But
yeah,
it might be gone now because it's No, I'll put WrestleMania in, and it's, I'm sure it was Rock. I'm sure it was Rock versus Cena was one of them, one of the matches.
Would it have been that long ago?
Yeah, because I'm sure it had the, I'm sure it was Orlando. Because it had like the big sunshine behind it.
Mm. Yeah, it must have been.
I will find it. I'll find it in my drafts. And
what I do know about that is near enough every one of my predictions was wrong. So that was great.
That's the best way. I mean, yeah. I've this will be way past recorded, but I've challenged Big Benny to a prediction contest for NXT TakeOver through Scottish Wrestling Discussion. And I know I'm going to lose very quickly because I'm terrible at guessing. I'm finding this. It's gone. Right, that's upsetting me. I'm going to have to go find it. Anyway, right. All the way to end the show. But again, thank you very much for joining us today. And hopefully, I'm blaming that you being pure evil for my swearing earlier. That's what we're going to blame it on. You've seeped through like a horcrux. And
the aim to make bad things happen.
That's it. Perfect way to end it. Thank you very much again. Cheers.
No problem at all.